Okay, perhaps we can begin. Good afternoon. Welcome to this public lecture organized by the Waterloo Institute for Sustainable Energy. My name is Jatin Nathwani. I'm the Executive Director of the Waterloo Institute for Sustainable Energy. So I welcome you again. Thank you for coming. I just want to ask a quick question. Anyone here who is not from inside the university? We make an effort, our desire is to be able to do these public talks so that members of the outside community can also participate. Sometimes we hold these things in the evening, late afternoons, 5 o'clock, 5:30 or so, and it varies depending on the subject who's speaking, that there can be some interest from members of the community. But the fact that you're from inside the university, no harm done. Thank you again. I will introduce our speaker. Briefly, and you probably also see the bio sketch on the app that had gone out to advertise this particular seminar. Professor John Boland, he's a mathematician, really, associate professor of environmental mathematics at the University of South Australia, UNISA. He has since 2000 been awarded, in conjunction with colleagues, 8 research grants from the principal research funding body in Australia, the Australian Research Council, similar to our National Research Council. Mm. These have been across the fields of integration of renewable energy into the electricity grid, a very important major subject area worldwide, obviously, certainly here in Ontario and Canada, and so it is in Australia. Again, he spans a wide area of research, water resource management, reduction of food waste, modeling the efficacy of permeable pavers, and so on. He also has, to his credit, a rather interesting, which I didn't know, the Boland Ridley-Lauren diffuse radiation model, adopted for use in solar resource estimation worldwide.
In meteor norm, yes.
Interesting.
The new version of it.
Significant achievement to his credit. A diffuse model used in renewable energy atlas for Australia. That was constructed by the Australian Bureau of Meteorology. He has led teams that have estimated the ecological footprint of the state of South Australia in various precincts within the state. Again, very significant, broad, tall order kind of activity, very impressive. He organizes the resource assessment streams at the World Renewables Energy Conference. Has been doing that since the year 2008, and has recently performed a similar duty at the Solar World Congress in Kassel, Germany. John and his wife have 50 fruit and nut trees in their suburban garden, which in conjunction with their vegetable garden produces 25% of their food. They also own a private conservation park where they are custodians of one of Australia's rarest plant species. A true person of wide scope. We welcome you to this seminar, to this public talk.
Thank you.
Thank you for, and we look forward to your comments.
Thanks a lot. Okay, just to give another bit of background, in 1965, a long, long time ago, I left high school in a place called Smiths Falls, which is between Kingston and Ottawa. When I didn't leave, I escaped to the University of Waterloo. I spent 5 years here and then realized that wasn't far enough away from Smiths Falls. So now, just to give a little sort of introduction, I'm from here. And the nice thing about this little video, it's a nice catchy tune and stuff like this, but it gives some nice photos of Australia, except none from Adelaide, unfortunately. I'll have to get a hold of this person. But it gives you a little bit of the scope of the country. And it has a variety of climates within the one country, right from sort of alpine-type regions in Tasmania right through to the wet tropics in the north. And of course, you'll see a couple of iconic things in this as well, in this, like that one, Uluru, in the center of Australia, near Alice Springs. This is the Blue Mountains west of Sydney, a beautiful area. If you've ever heard of the Great Ocean Road in the south of Victoria, these are the 12 apostles, which you see if you go on the drive. And I must say that there's lots of people that do that from North America and Europe. So many so that there's signs along the road now, drive on the left. And this is a terrible thing to eat, but that's the Gold Coast, which is not much fun, I don't think, personally. But there's lots of beaches in Australia, obviously. And some waterfalls. And this is in Melbourne. And so is the next slide, I think. Oh, no, that's, that's Sydney. It's the harbour in Sydney. That's Goat Island in the centre. And, of course, the Opera House, which you probably have seen images of before. Oh, that was on before. A very decorative plane. And you probably know or heard of Steve Irwin. In fact, I didn't know about Steve Irwin until the last time I was in Canada and somebody mentioned him. On our property near Murray Bridge, we have a few of those kangaroos. Some of the desert country. And the emblem of Australia. Melbourne at night. There's one slide I'm just waiting for. Oh, that's Sydney Harbour again. And the Harbour Bridge, obviously. There's a road train. Okay. Now. Okay. All right. I'm going to talk about the volatility of wind farm output and or the changing variance in wind farm output. And I'll explain why in a minute, and some of those pictures over on the side will have something to do with it as well. Now, there's going to be, I don't want to sort of patronize you and say, well, there's going to be some mathematics in here that might be this level or this level, depending on what your backgrounds are and stuff like this. But I think it's important that I've included some fairly, not totally, I've left out the proofs, by the way, but some fairly rigorous mathematics in it, because, as in the introduction, it was mentioned that I was at the Solar World Congress three weeks ago, and I'll tell you a little anecdote that might tell you why I'm so keen on introducing some in-depth analysis into some of this area. David Rene, who's from NREL in the United States and also the head of ISIS, the International Solar Energy Society, and I organized a stream for the conference on solar resource assessment and forecasting. And at the end of the conference, I gave a sort of wrap-up of that stream. And I said that many years ago, when I used to go to a conference of that nature, like the Solar World Congress or similar, and there'd be maybe one session on solar resource assessment with maybe five speakers, and basically we were talking to each other. In those days, of course, the most use of solar equipment was basically on either somebody's rooftop or in a remote area power supply system. And, you know, if the expected amount of output from the system was not as you wanted, well, you just said, oh, well, that was bad luck. But these days, because we have wind farm development and also now solar farm development worth hundreds of millions of dollars each. And you go to the bank to try to get some backing for these installations. They want more rigor in the estimation of not only the output expected, but also the variability that can be expected too for the risk analysis. Okay, so at the Solar World Congress in Kassel, we had 5 oral sessions and 2 poster sessions on resource assessment, different from years and years ago. And at each of the sessions, we'd have about 50 people in the audience. So we weren't just a few people talking to ourselves anymore. Okay, so it's become much more of a studied topic. Okay, so just an acknowledgement that the work here is supported by this 2 projects from the Australian Research Council, and also the industry partner is the Australian Electricity, actually it's the Australian Energy Market Operator. I shouldn't be electricity, because they also manage the gas market as well. And we also, I was going to mention before that there's a number of people working on these 2 projects, and as I mentioned to Jatin before, I think there's about 6 people working together with me. I'm the sort of leader of the projects. Not one was born in Australia, but we're all Australians. So this shows you something about Australia, the breadth and depth, shall we say. And Adelaide is right here, just on that little bay called Spencer Gulf. Okay, and as I say, you can see the different sort of types of climates in the country. And so even in when you're thinking about doing like resource assessment for solar, you've got to think of these different climates and what's happening differently in the different places too. The Australian National Electricity Market is not exactly quite the right name for it, because it doesn't include Western Australia. That's sort of too far away, and there's a lot of land in between where there's not many people. But it does include this long belt down from North Queensland, down through Brisbane, Sydney, Melbourne, Adelaide, and Tasmania. And just for the technophiles in the audience, the connector between Tasmania and Victoria is a high voltage DC line under the Bass Strait. Okay, so you can see that even from the, shall we say, topography of the grid, there's going to be some problems managing it. Okay, because if you look here, here's South Australia. South Australia's got 1.5 million people approximately, mostly in Adelaide, just over 1 million in Adelaide itself. But sometimes we need to pass electricity either towards Victoria or back from Victoria, and there's this one little line down here, and it's only a 500 kV line, I think. So it's not very useful in many respects. One of the big things that we're looking at the moment is how do we augment the grid to cater for increased renewables in the grid and also increased demand as well. And it's really funny, there's a big debate going on in Australia at the moment, because there's a lot of renewables embedded in the grid now, a reasonable amount compared to even 10 years ago. And electricity prices are rising, so a lot of people are saying, oh, it's because of, you know, the support for these renewables that are being put into the grid. Well, in fact, what it's really about is augmenting the grid to take care of high demand on hot summer afternoons. In South Australia, as an example, the average, because it's only, as I say, 1.5 million people, the average demand is something like 1,200 megawatts. The peak recorded demand was 3,300 megawatts. Okay, so it's a very peaky load. All right, so it's really difficult at times to manage that system. And if, you know, something goes down in one place, often there's a domino effect as well. But, one time there was a bushfire near this interconnector, and for safety reasons, it tripped out all of this, and then it sort of headed off into Adelaide, tripping as it went. And so there was a big sort of, I think about 30% of the homes in South Australia are out in the morning, just around breakfast time and stuff. Okay, it's important to know the context you're working in. When I'm talking about wind farms, well, first off, in South Australia, in 2003, there was zero energy into the grid from wind farms. Today, 20% of the electricity supply is from wind farms, and growing dramatically all the time. So you can see as well, going back to that previous slide, what's going to happen is, well, in fact, even now, at times, because if the average demand is 1,200, and you've got almost 1,200 supply from wind farms, the capacity, and the capacity factor at particular times is over 90%, not over the, you know, average over the year by any means, but at particular times, there's chances that you might have more supply from the wind farms than the whole demand of the state, which has happened a few times. But can you push it to somewhere else where the demand is higher? That's one of the big questions, okay? All right, now, the electricity market. It's a very particular one and operates, I'm not totally certain, but I believe the only other market that operates in the sort of time scales that we do is the West Texas grid. Okay, I don't know of any other market that operates like this. It operates on a 5-minute basis. Okay, and is cleared every half hour. Explain what that means. So every 5 minutes, generators bid into the market. Okay, they submit a bid stack detailing their offers of the volumes at each of 10 price bands. So at this band, we can offer this amount, at this band, this amount, at this band, this amount. Okay? The Australian Energy Market Operator, I got it right this time, runs a linear program to decide how much energy to take from each generator. Okay? And so you work up the bands from the lowest price up to where you need the final supply. Okay? And then everybody gets that price for all the electricity that's generated. Okay? It's not the everybody gets the marginal price. And at the end of the half hour, the spot price is set as the average of the 5-minute prices. And all the energy dispatched to the system during the half hour is at that spot price. Now, the interesting thing is, the nice thing about that in some respects is because the market is cleared every half an hour, basically you have to be able to know what the total output put from every farm was in that half hour. So there's actually a website in Australia where for the, I think there's 147 wind farms in Australia now. I think it's something, that sticks in my mind. I was told just a couple of weeks ago, and I've got data from them. And so all the output from all those farms on a half-hour basis, not 5 minutes, half-hour basis, is available publicly. And so it's a great resource for analysis. Speaking about the sort of peakiness of the demand, we also have, shall we say, peakiness of the spot price. So the demand is in blue, the spot price is in red, and this was January 2010, and you can see here that actually does say $10,000 per megawatt hour. Okay, so the average spot price is, I think, about $70 per megawatt hour, maybe a little bit less, but it can peak up to $10,000 per megawatt hour.
Does the operator allow that to go there?
Yes.
Or do they use administrative limits for?
That's the administrative limit. And actually, it's increased now to $12,000. And there's a lot of, well, we've debated it with them quite a bit. And in Europe, it's 4,000 euro, I think, so it's, you know, still pretty high is the limit. We've debated it with them a bit, but there's pros and cons about it in some ways, because what happens is that you want, on that sort of peaky type of demand, you want a lot of peaking power plant available. Okay, but it might not be needed very often during the year. Okay, however, you've got to get the people to invest in that plant so it's available when you need it. And so if they're only operating maybe 10 half hours a year, they've still got to make money to pay back the investment. So, I mean, that's the argument on the one side. Okay, what happens on the other side of the coin, of course, is that what happens is the generators get the money not from the public, but from the retailers. Okay, so it's a totally deregulated power market in or electricity market, especially in South Australia. It's growing to that in the other states as well. It's like Canada, you know, there's different rules in different states and all that sort of stuff. But, you know, then the retailer sells it to the consumer at a levelized price. And so the consumer is sort of buffered from it. They don't really see what's happening. I mean, obviously, they're impacted because, you know, the average price that they pay is inflated because of these particular periods when the price is high to the retailers. But then, of course, there's all sorts of hedging going on as well. I mean, it's a minefield for speculators. It's just pretty wild sort of stuff. And in fact, I've got a PhD student working on gaming in the electricity market as well. And so it's quite interesting. But the other thing that I think is interesting from this graph before we head on to the wind farms per se is that you'll notice that sometimes, like there, and even in this period, there's some fairly high demand where when you've got similar demands, you've got a high spot price. And what happens is, of course, that they actually can game, in a way, we reckon they can anyway, by setting up their bid stacks in the right manner to sort of take advantage of this. So you can see, in a way here, this is the sort of stack you could put in if you figure there's going to be fairly low demand in the next 5 minutes, and so you don't want to participate in the market because you know the price is going to be low. Okay, so you put all the volume you're going to bid at the highest price, knowing that you're not... Oh, I should have got that out here. Just a second. Let me just grab this. Forgot to get my pointer out. So you can see here that probably the spot price will be for the amount in that sort of band, so you're not even going to participate in the market. You don't want to, okay? When there might be medium demand, and these are low, high, medium demand times. We've gone through the data. And this is a medium demand time. You think, oh, well, the spot price is probably going to be somewhere around here. I'll throw in a bit of my production and get something, okay? And this is the place where you figure there's going to be a high demand period, okay? And so you put a whole pile. This is actually at a negative price. So if you were just, if the spot price was here, you'd lose money. And once in a while, their forecasts are not too good, and they actually provide money, provide electricity and pay to do it. Okay? But what they're hoping is that the spot price will go up to here. In fact, they're really hoping it goes up into that band, and they get everything at that price. Okay? Now, as I'm going through, obviously we'll have question time at the end, but if there's some particular things for clarification, please yell out. Okay? So you can see there's interest. It's an interesting sort of thing on itself, just the electricity market in Australia. As I said, wind energy provides a lot of, 20% on over the year of the electricity demand in South Australia. And you can see that there's quite a number of wind farms, but they're all pretty much along that western coast, because if you think of it, we're in the roaring 40s, and so you get all the winds going across. When I say the roaring 40s, 40 south latitude, Adelaide is about 35 south, so we're in that sort of band, okay? So we're trying to take advantage of the high wind speeds on the coast, and so they're all around there pretty much. But you can see, of course, that there's going to be some problems for people estimating what's going on when you have them all subject to the same synoptic patterns as well. Okay? How, you know, do they all work in tandem or is there some local effects that make them not work in tandem? In fact, the first bit of work I did, I think the second bit of work I did for the energy market operator on a consulting job was to try and figure out, and this was back in the days when we had one wind farm, how conjoined would the output be from wind farms at a number of places in South Australia. Now, you know, it's only a silly mathematician that would take on that sort of job of when you've got one wind farm trying to figure out how correlated all the wind farms are when the rest are just hypothetical. But so I used wind speeds. And that was interesting because I found a high degree of correlation. But since I've been working with the actual output from the farms, because I've got access to the data of the output, not just at the half-hour level, but much higher frequencies. Much higher frequencies, which I'll explain in a minute. I had a PhD student working on that correlation. And because of the local topographical effects, they're not nearly as correlated as if you use just wind speeds from the Bureau of Meteorology weather stations nearby. They're still quite correlated, but not as bad as we thought. And I'm going to do some more work on that now with the half-hour outputs for the 140 farms all over Australia. That should be fun. So this is a farm on York Peninsula, which is the next peninsula over from where Adelaide is. As I said, the installed capacity is creeping up towards 1,200 megawatts at the moment, but rising rapidly. And in fact, just to give you an idea of what's going to happen, on this peninsula, that's the Eyre Peninsula, there's very few people, and yet there's a talk of probably putting in another 2,000 megawatts on that peninsula soon, or, you know, over the next few years. Okay, I think in some respects this slide, you know the sort of thing that we're trying to do, reduce dependence on conventional centralized generation to a situation where more diversified, more volatile, and less controllable generation sources contribute a significant percentage of the energy. And the head of research, I could probably say, from the energy market operator, his sort of version of the future is that there'll be really very limited base load in the medium-term future. And we'll have to develop techniques for figuring out how to manage that. Now, when I'm talking about modeling the volatility, I hope I'm not telling you how to suck eggs, but I'll just go back a step and talk a little bit about a very simple statistical problem that people see the first time they ever see statistics, and it's about line of best fit. When you do a line of best fit through some data, what you're always sort of interested in is that along that line, the data is in one homogeneous band. And the reason for that is that if you make a forecast or prediction at this value of X of what the Y value will be, you'll want to put error bounds on that forecast, on that prediction. You know, the so-called prediction interval, okay? In order to do that, you've got to know the variance for that particular value of X, because the hypothesis is that there's a little normal distribution for each X, okay? But how do you estimate that variance when for any one X value, you've only got one point? Well, you rely on the principle of ergodicity, that you can estimate the variance for any particular x value by taking the overall variance away from the line of all the points. Okay? So that's the basic assumption that you work under in linear regression. And even if you have this sort of picture, you can still do it. Because if you think of it, the variance is changing systematically. So you can actually model that change. Fine. The trouble with a number of situations, and one of them is the output from wind farms, is that you have the variance changing stochastically. So you've got to produce a model for that. And I'll show you why I say it changes stochastically. So we're going to look at we're focusing on two timescales, 5 minute and half hour, because those are the most relevant timescales for the electricity market in Australia. And I'm focusing in this talk just on the 5-minute scale. Okay? Now, we use both classical and modern time series. I say modern time series analysis because it's sort of coming out of work that's been done in financial markets, basically, and similar. And also some dynamical systems stuff as well, which I'll just touch on briefly. Okay. The other thing that's interesting, and this is, helps us a lot when we're trying to form an estimate of the variability, okay, or the volatility. It's, you know, in financial markets they talk about volatility, and usually in statistics we talk about variance. But you could almost think, I've been trying to find a precise definition of volatility, but it almost seems to me like it's a good way to typify time varying variance. I don't know. It sounds like a decent sort of thing. Okay, now, in the first instance, because we're interested in 5-minute and 30-minute data sets, and, you know, the 10-second data is energy, so we can just add up the energy over 5 minutes, and that's the energy output for 5 minutes, etc. Okay? So we tried to see if there's any seasonality. It doesn't appear to be much. Some little inklings of changes over systematic changes over the day in certain months, but it's not very significant except for 1 or 2 months. What we want to do is forecast the output level, but we want to put error bounds on the forecast. Okay? Now, there's been a lot of work at higher time scales doing this thing, sort of thing, with numerical weather predictors and ensemble forecasting and stuff. But and in fact, I'm working with some people from the University of New South Wales in Sydney, where I'm looking at solar radiation on this on short time scales using statistical modeling. They're using numerical weather predictors on the longer time scales. And what we want to do is sort of marry the two at the boundary if we can. Okay. But as I say, we want to forecast the volatility. And I say we have to forecast the volatility or change variance because, as we'll see, this is more of the typical pattern, not this or this. Okay. So this is just a typical sort of output of energy at 5-minute intervals, and you can see it is highly volatile in the sort of more intuitive sense. And that's 10-second intervals. It's just, you know, a bit more variation, but same sort of pattern. Okay, now, once again, sorry if you know, if people know lots about time series modeling. I don't know people's background, so I'll go back to the beginning, shall we say, quickly. Identification of what sort of model, and I'm talking about Box-Jenkins models, so you might have heard that term at the very least, I don't know. They did a seminal work on a thing called, well, autoregressive integrated moving average models, but I'm going to just talk about, well, principally autoregressive in this case. And I'll tell what that is in a second. And we used two little graphs to try and understand what type of process it might follow, either an autoregressive or, forget about the integrated for the moment, or an autoregressive moving average process, okay? And I'll sort of explain a little bit about that in a minute. And the sample autocorrelation function is a measure of the linear relationship between time series observations separated by some time period or lag, okay? In other words, now, one of the problems is that if you think of it, if xt is correlated with xt minus 1, in other words, the series at lag 1, okay, and xt minus 1 is correlated with xt minus 2, in other words, lag 1 is correlated with lag 2, then there's almost like a transitive effect where it looks like xt is correlated with xt minus 2. And even if that's not the case, it'll still look like it. But, in fact, that's why you have this partial autocorrelation function. It separates out that interaction between lags. Oops, I went backwards. And so what we found was that for a lot of the wind farms, we could actually model the, or at least the movement in the data, pretty well with an autoregressive an autoregressive model of lag 2 or lag 3. What that means is, just to give you an idea of the sort of form of it, it's quite a simple structure when you think of it. Okay, so basically, it's like a multiple regression. Okay, you're regressing the data time t with the previous time step and the and two time steps before. And so you estimate alpha 1 and alpha 2, and this is just the error term, you know. So it's quite a simple structure. That's the AR2 model. Okay, and you can see it does a reasonable sort of fit. Now, once again, in classical time series analysis, what you really want, oh, I took it away. So you've got something equivalent to that first diagram here, is that this error term, you want it to be IID. Independent and identically distributed, okay? Because that was the same thing as in that, what you assume for linear regression, all right? And what you do to check that, the independence part, usually with classical time series analysis, is you look at the autocorrelation function for the residuals. And these red lines here are the sort of confidence interval for a hypothesis test that the contribution to the autocorrelation at that lag is equal to zero. So you can see if the blue bits are between the two confidence intervals, there's no correlation. Okay, so this is the sort of diagram you want. And usually in time series analysis, especially, you know, in a very mundane sort of view of it, you say, oh, that's cool, everything's fine. Z is independent now. There's no autocorrelation left. We've got the whole model. In financial market modeling, what people found was that often, though, they've taken a proxy. So this means it's like, you know, it's independent in the mean. But they've often taken a proxy for the variance. And that what they do is you take Z, the Z values, square them, work out the autocorrelation function for the squared residuals, which looks like this. And if you don't get them between those red lines, it means that the variance is changing over time, okay? And the people that worked on that, and so in other words, the noise is uncorrelated but dependent, okay? Because uncorrelated is just a linear idea, okay? Not okay, and this is prevalent in financial markets, and it's called volatility clustering. So if you look at the stock market, you'll see that periods of high volatility for any index are followed by periods of low volatility. Okay, and then back to high, but you don't know when it's going to switch. And you don't know how many levels of the volatility there are in the series either. First person that talked about this was a guy called Engel, and he worked at I love when you have to say the autoregressive conditional heteroscedastic. It's always good to sort of wow your friends with these impressive terms. Model to cater for this. Conditional header, well, of course, in that initial sort of thing about the line of best fit, the data is homoscedastic. It's all in one even band. So heteroscedastic just means there's changing variance. That's all. Okay? But it sounds impressive. And so this should have a long autoregressive structure. Okay? And that was one of the problems, because you have to have this quite unparsimonious model for the autoregressive structure. So a guy named Boland developed the generalized autoregressive conditional heteroscedastic model. Okay, and interestingly enough, you can often model it in this sort of way. So this was the first stab at modeling the changing variance. Okay, so this is the variance at time t. It's connected with the variance at time t minus 1, but also, sorry for changing nomenclature. This is the square of the residual. This should be zt squared at time t minus 1. Okay, so that was the so-called Gartsch model. So we looked at that first. We also applied hidden Markov models to the variance. And one of the interesting things was that when this was to the variance, so it was interesting in the sense that we found that there were only two states to the volatility. It was either highly volatile or lowly volatile. There's no sort of medium state. And some people in Europe have done a similar sort of work, because hidden Markov model means a Markov chain type of model, but you're not identifying the states in the process a priori. You're sort of letting the data determine how many states there are in the data. Okay? In Europe, with a number of offshore wind farms, some people have found that there's actually three states to the volatility rather than two. Okay, so might be something different. I'd like to look at some data for onshore wind farms in Europe to see if that switches to two as well. Anyway, on to the guts of the thing. We have some extra data available, as I said. We've got actually output at 10 seconds. And the reason that they record at 10-second intervals is because that's to do with managing the stability of the grid itself. You don't want the frequency to change, of the output to change too violently, or you're going to have troubles with the lines. And so what we did was develop an idea of how we can take that 10-second data and make use of it to try and estimate the volatility at the 5-minute or half-hour time scale. Okay, so first off, we're going to model the 10-second data. And it turns out that this AR3 model, similar to that but just one more term, gives an idea of what's going on fairly reasonably. The AR8, we tried that as well, but it was the one that sort of the diagnostics suggested we should use, but the AR3 seemed to work just as well, and it's more parsimonious. So what we're going to do is basically in this line here, I should have just kept this out, is the important one. We're going to use the model of the high frequency data to estimate the volatility at lower frequencies. So I'm going to describe how we do this. One thing that's going to be useful, now there's a bit of maths here in the next couple of slides, but this is the way we write an AR3 process. As I said, just one more term than here. And we can write it in polynomial form, shall we say, where the multiplier of the XT is 1 minus alpha 1b minus alpha 2b squared minus alpha 3b cubed, where this is just the backshift operator. So b times XT equals XT minus 1. So this is an operator form, basically. Okay? Why we do this is that then we can actually take that polynomial and invert it, okay? So we can write it in this form that xt is in something to do with just the z terms. And this is often done in classical time series analysis as well. You can actually write xt in the form of an infinite sum of the error terms back in time. Okay? And this is a classic sort of method used in time series analysis. Now, we're going to make use of that. Okay? And even you can prove some recursion relationships for these coefficients. So, you know, you can sort of work around with it doing a bit of algebra. I'm not going to dwell on that. I'm just going to show that we're going to use that in our formulation. So this is the most important slide, I think, in the whole talk in terms of the theory we've developed. And the way we're going to talk about this is going to be the time series at intervals of every 10 seconds. So just think XT is the 10 second data. YT is the time series of aggregated energy output at every 5 minutes. Okay? So we can sort of write YT is, and we had to think about this terminology quite a bit, but what we're trying to say is that basically YT is the sum of 30 XTs, that's all. But we had to sort of think how to do these subscripts. Okay? So X of T minus I over 30 represents the wind energy output at the ith 10 second prior to time T. Okay? Now, this is sort of something from classic probability theory. Just think of it this way. If, indeed, that all of these variables were independent and identically distributed, okay, you could just work out the variance of this variable by summing the variance of those variables. Okay? Classic first step in probability. Trouble is, the X's are not. They follow that AR3 model. So how do we work out the variance of Y, the variance at 5 minutes, by working out how these are interrelated and write it down in a nice straightforward form? Well, reasonably anyway. Okay? Well, the nice thing is you can think. What we could do, if we just did it laboriously, we could say, okay, well, wait a minute. XT is alpha 1 XT minus 1 plus alpha 2 XT minus 2 plus alpha 3 XT minus 3 plus ZT. We could do a similar substitution here and for all of these. Okay? And then we've eliminated any of the T times or T terms in X. And then we could do it again and again and again. Okay? And keep back substituting and end up getting just a sum of a whole pile of ZTs. And in fact, that's why we've looked at this sort of form of it. Because if for each time step, we put in an infinite sum like this. Okay? So this one starts ZT. For XT minus 1, we'll have psi 0, ZT minus 1, etc. Okay? So there's a lot of algebra in this. But when you're done with it, you get an expression like this, this infinite sum. And all of these coefficients you can determine from that recursive relationship. Now, we're going to miss out all the stuff that proves that this infinite sum converges and all that sort of stuff, because we don't need that, but it does. The key thing is that in this long bit of algebra, you can end up writing your variance of, you know, YT in this form. Okay, so you have all of this coefficients times Z times the variance at time T, okay, plus a lot of other terms times the variance at time T minus 1 of the error term, okay, and go back in time. Okay, and so as long as this sum converges, and as long as you can estimate it with a sort of relatively small number of steps, you can actually get, and this is just mess, but it you know, it's sort of trying to put it all together. But the big thing here is that what this is saying is that the variance of that 5 minute data can be written as a coefficient times the variance of the error term within that particular interval, another coefficient, the error term in the time interval before, the 5 minute interval before, and on back in time. And as long as this converges rapidly enough, you get an estimate for the variance of the Y. Okay, and this is just more algebra. We don't need that. So how do you use that? Okay, well, this just gives an idea. By using that sum, here's output, the blue of 5 minute data, and this is the estimated standard deviation from that big long calculation at each point in time. Okay, so you can think, say I'm whereabouts, okay? Say I'm here, and I want to forecast the output for the next time step. Okay, I can make an estimate of what it's going to be using my model for the 5 minute data. and then use that standard deviation to put error bounds around the forecast, because I can forecast as long as I get a model for the volatility as well. And so this is one way to be able to put error bounds on your forecast of the output from the wind farm. Okay? Now, you see it's highly volatile and stuff like this. The hope, of course, is that if you have a wide enough spatial diversity of the farms, that once you start adding up the output from a number of farms, given that it's all sort of, you know, available reasonably through the grid, hopefully that'll be smoothed out quite substantially as well. Now, just to sort of give a flavor of further work, of course, once you've got that estimate of the variance, you've got to build a model for that changing variance, okay? Well, just to quickly sort of go to that, what we've done is that there's an interesting person who I went and visited last year in Italy, a guy called Carlo Lucaroni, and he has been working on electricity markets, and he's actually grabs, as mathematicians do, he's found a model that's been used for something quite far-fetched away from what he works on. It's the firing of synapses in the brain, and saw that, oh, the sort of data that they've got from the firing of synapses has a similar structure to electricity markets. So he said, I can probably apply that dynamical system model that they're using to my stuff. And then I saw the stuff he had for electricity markets, and I said, oh, it looks like my wind farm output variability. Maybe I can apply his model to that. So it's done a chain. And it's basically, this is in the sort of finite difference form of it. But so I won't go into that too much, except to say that this lambda's key, because if you can see here, we've got non-linear terms in this bracket. So the lambda, if it's non-zero, means you've got a non-linearity in there. Okay. So, but anyway, this is just an idea of the type of things you can get out of it. This is the variance, the blue, the changing variance, estimated using that model that I've just talked about. Here's the ARMA, or like a Gartsch formulation of it, the green, and this is that dynamic system model. And you can see it doesn't quite get up to the peaks, but it gets closer, higher up to the peaks than the green does, at least. So that's the thing, that this Lucaroni model can sort of capture the peaks much better. And in fact, we've looked at using it in solar radiation data. This is deseasoned, which means taking out all the embedded cycles in the solar radiation time series. And you can see if you use an AR4 model for this deseasoned data, that's the red. You can't get up to the peaks. But this dynamical system model, you can reach the peaks. And so it's quite good. In fact, we've gone further on to sort of mixing the two for forecasting solar radiation. But I won't go into that. This is just something about some of the types of mixed integer nonlinear programming models you need for trying to figure out how to augment the grid with different amounts of new lines or increased voltage on particular lines and stuff like this. I won't really talk about that. Just quickly to finish off, this is just a conceptual sort of thing. Because what our goal, of course, is to try and figure out how you can get as high a penetration as possible of renewables into the grid, okay? And still either match demand or tweak demand. This is the other sort of idea, tweak demand so it's easier to match the two. As I say, this is just highly conceptual, but just a sort of thing about how we're trying to think about it at the moment. Okay, so the demand is the green. Say we have a whole pile of solar installations, so we can get a lot of output from them, the red, and we've got wind output, the blue. Now, these are all real, but they're sort of magnified, the red and the blue, just to sort of say, if you had a lot available, this would be the sort of form of it. And these are profiles, obviously, over, 3 days. And why I say mix your solar here is because I was at an energy storage forum in Beijing last year, and a person from Southern California was talking about how to figure out how much energy storage he'd need to store solar during the peak time of the day when the demand, when the supply is maximum, until later in the day when he could send it off to the grid and take advantage of the spot price. Okay? And I said, well, you know, maybe, I went up afterwards and I said, maybe you can sort of adjust the amount of installed storage you need by taking at least part of your array and pointing it west instead of just pointing it towards the equator. Okay? And if your goal is to maximize your profit rather than maximize your energy gain, then maybe that's a better idea. Okay? So this is mix here of equatorial facing solar and west facing solar. So you can see here is a good example. Total energy is less, but you've pushed the peak more towards when the peak demand is. Okay? And if it's advantageous financially, that might be a good thing to do. And so if you mix the lot of them together, this is where you would then figure out how much storage you might need. Okay? Because you've got oversupply here, but undersupply here, so you want to store this part to fill in this gap, store this part to fill in this gap, etc. Okay? Now, obviously, to do this in the true version, you've got to do it as a stochastic problem. You can't just take the average supply and demand and all that sort of stuff. So the nice thing about that for me as a mathematician is we like those sorts of problems. So, okay? And I think that's about it. Just as a quick sort of add, so this is what we're actually trying to work on from out of all, emanating from all that. And it's towards electricity without fossil fuels. Find the best mix of renewables, demand management, and storage. And Barry might be involved in this as well. Okay, and the interesting thing here, I'll just go down a bit. One thing that's interesting, I think, here, so far, the leaders of this project are myself, a guy called Peter Pudney, who's another mathematician. He's actually been heavily involved in the solar car race for years and years and years, has been the strategist for the Aurora team that's, I think, come second about three times, and I think they actually won it one year. And he also is a co-inventor of a vehicle called Trev, which is a three-wheel electric vehicle that is, you know, primarily for commuting and stuff like this. It isn't commercial yet, but we still hope. There's a person that's from public health, and his key interests are assessment of the connections between human health effects and generation technologies, understanding the environmental, social, and health impacts of rising energy prices and the changing ways we use and pay for electricity. And also, of course, a marketer, because often there's sort of bad press for particular initiatives in the energy field. Now, you'll notice that there's two things missing yet. There's no engineers in there yet, because the Barbara Hardy Institute has a lot of engineers in it. And when I present this project as a proposal to the whole of the institute, the ones that are interested can say, I want to be on board. Okay? The other person that I think would be very interesting to have in there, and I haven't sort of identified the person yet, is an economist. Because I think unless you understand, as Jatin was saying last night in a presentation that I went to, you know, unless you understand the incentives or the structure of the incentives you put into place to help get this off the ground, you can do some really drastically wrong things. You know, there's a lot of talk last night about the feed-in tariff that's present in Ontario, and it sounded like there was some good and bad things about it, shall we say, and could be better designed. Okay, it sounded like. Okay, well, I hope that was of interest and use, and thank you very much. Thank you. And if you're interested in more about this project or even helping us with it, feel free.
We have time for questions.
Yes.
I have a couple of comments and questions. You mentioned about the existence of five-minute markets.
Yep.
Sorry, is one of them.
So, oh, is it? Yeah. Oh, okay.
Stereo, PJM.
Yeah. Well, the problem with these markets, though, is that I don't know how it's in Australia, but for example, if you look at the markets, the neighboring markets, how are they ahead in the market structure,
yep,
in which all these volatility sort of dies away because you define the prices in the previous day.
Yeah, yeah.
Then you penalize those that are gaining from it.
Yep.
So that kind of behavior is not observed in those markets.
Yep.
Now, what I have a question is regarding the data you mentioned about the stack, the bidding stack.
Yeah, yeah.
You mentioned data. I'm curious where you're getting this, because here it's a private thing. You do not get information for who is bidding what. And I'm curious whether
that's
available or it's just an estimate?
No, it's available. Yeah, in a sort of general term, you don't know exactly when they're using each
after
stack.
After
the market is settled, it's not.
No, here, even yeah, after the market is settled, you don't know who bid what.
Yeah, there's
the prices are on the block on the north because they have a location marginal price structure,
yep,
and they provide that. But you cannot know what, because that then the generators basically provide information to the,
yep,
operator.
So yep.
I was curious about that.
No, that it is available. There's probably in Australia in general quite a bit more data available about how things operate than quite a lot of other places.
Well, here you have a whole sea of data.
Yeah.
You can get, but bidding, no,
yeah,
not
yeah, sure.
I have another comment regarding the forecasting of wind. I was at a conference a couple of months ago,
yeah,
in Europe, and they were a good part of the conference. Power conference,
yep,
was dedicated to with these wind forecasting,
yep,
issues. One observation they made in Denmark, Germany, Spain,
yep,
where they have a lot of these distributed geographically, and I
yep
mentioned,
yep,
is that when you add all of these up, that volatility goes away.
Well, I mean, the hope is that, yes, exactly. No, I mean, you know, in our situation as well. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the data that they show.
Yep.
I mean, they have some cases 20%,
yep,
of the energy cost.
Yep.
And then they were showing that instead of seconds, you move to minutes, even in one case, a couple of hours, in which you could forecast,
mm-hmm,
basically how the wind is going down and you can dispatch it.
Yep.
I was surprised by that. And interestingly enough, in Spain, for example, now the markets, Spanish operators are now bidding. Wind operators are bidding in the market.
Yeah.
So because, yep, they can basically predict these,
yep,
aggregated.
That's right.
So it's quite interesting. Now my question is in this regard is with regard to wind forecasting.
Yep.
Is the issue whether you, I mean, we look for example at similar models for price forecasting.
Yep.
The high volatility made it really no good.
Yep.
This time series,
yep,
correlation basically showed that the volatility was too high.
Yeah. Yeah.
So with a colleague here, Italian colleague, we'll be looking at other type of techniques, hybrid methods.
Yep.
For price forecasting.
Yep.
It's a bit tougher than wind.
Yeah.
Because of the volatility,
yeah,
that,
yeah,
you show there.
That's right.
2000 is the cutoff.
Okay.
So, but anyway, in that case, are you aware of people approaching the wind forecasting using hybrid methods, non-linear techniques?
Yes. Yeah, I mean, there's quite a variety of techniques being used. And in fact,
are you aware of how successful that they
have been? I think, you know, sort of overall limit. Mixed success, probably, I think you could say. One of the interesting things is because of this being announced, this seminar, I've been in contact with somebody from statistics here who's actually on sabbatical at the moment, and she's been doing some work as well using Markov switching models and stuff like this as well. And so we're going to talk a bit more about, you know, how we can sort of mix things together. As I say, hybrid models, I think, are probably the way to go to at least improve as much as possible. I'm not really sure how close we can get to it, to be honest.
In the case of price forecasting, we were quite successful identifying parameters that influence the price.
Yes, 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 Yes. So
you have explanatory variables.
Yeah, I mean, that's the nice thing about that, isn't it? The explanatory variables, yeah, I don't know. The explanatory variables, to a small extent, here's an example, for instance, in solar forecasting, at the Solar World Congress, there's a woman called Elke Lorenz from the University of Oldenburg in Germany. And what she's doing is sort of trying to forecast the motion of cloud motion vectors, it's called, to sort of see where the clouds might be moving at any time. And, you know, I sort of have the idea that if I can mix the sort of statistical version with those, maybe we can get further in terms of lowering the volatility of the forecasts. But yeah, I think that's the way to go, to try and, you know, get as many other variables, if you can possibly find them, to help, you know, say what's happening.
One more question.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Christina Baker from the Faculty of Environment. I've done a little bit of work on complementarity, and I also worked on the precursor to the FIT in the agency and government. And I just was wondering about this project and maybe previous work. One of the problems that has come up with renewables integration is around the issue of queuing and procurement.
Yeah.
So, and I see how that could affect, for instance, the final supply mix. There in Ontario, there have been issues around congestion.
Yep. Yep.
And that type of thing. And I'm just wondering, does this project or another one that you're working on address the issue of queuing? What would be an ideal procurement strategy in order to get the best queue? And for instance, like Germany has a conflict clearinghouse now for these types of queuing issues.
Right.
And then also sort of between the resources, for instance, because as you've shown, there's a lot of potential for complementarity and this variability. So I'm just wondering if you can comment on that.
Just trying to think.
First of all, are these all contractual?
No.
Output through contracts or through bidding?
Bidding.
Bidding
into
the market.
Yeah. Yeah. So, one of the things that's happened because of possible congestion issues and stuff like this in South Australia in particular is that, different from Europe, where, or at least up until recently, you're supposed to sort of take all the renewables, in South Australia, they sort of forecast the idea that, oh, we're going to have some troubles in the future. So early on in the piece, every wind farm that came on stream, they made it semi-scheduled rather than fully scheduled like a coal-fired power plant or something like this. It's totally biddable, dispatchable, all that sort of stuff. And the semi-scheduled nature of it means that you can actually tell the wind farm operators to turn back the supply if it's going to provide problems for the network, either in terms of, you know, the frequency problems or something like that, or oversupply, okay? And so, yeah, one of the things, of course, you've got to figure out then is that if you're trying to analyze the situation, you've got to have that metadata as well as to what the sort of organizational features were too. And but as to, you know, the full sort of work on complementarity and stuff like this, I think we're sort of just verging towards that. We're trying to, I guess in a way, trying to understand the tools that we need as much as possible sort of first, so we don't, you know, over or underestimate the problem, shall we say, because that often happens, I think.
The question she was getting at, though, here in Ontario is different.
Right.
In essence, all wind is contracted.
Oh, right.
So you produce anything, it just simply goes on the grid.
No, not ours.
Then, when you get into low load conditions, you do nothing with wind output. What you actually do is spill water or turn back nuclear or anything.
In a way, what we do here is that if we can possibly take the wind, we'll take it and cut back something else. But I mean, it's possibly a little bit easier in our situation maybe as well because of the fact that it's such a peaky sort of load. So there's a lot of plant that sits idle a lot of the time anyway. So it's just that you might not call on that, right? So that may be a difference. Yes?
First of all, I'd like to thank you, sir, so much for your presentation. I just have a couple of comments, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
The first one, concerning the result that we you show us,
yeah.
because actually I was confusing a little bit. Is this is a model for modeling the week over a historical period, or this is something that no. is for forecasting?
Forecasting.
Okay, yeah. Because actually I have a comment here. Usually the people that they are working on the climate forecasting
tools, yep.
They claim that the time series is not. They don't rely on it when it comes to wind speed, and they are using yep. other models like either like the grade reductor techniques or even the probabilistic forecasting tools. And
yep.
they are trying to in these tools they are trying to capture. The temporal correlations and the spatial correlation as much as they can.
But, yep.
And they usually say that okay, that the time series model can be used for load forecasting, for example.
Yeah.
But they cannot be yep. used for forecasting wind speed.
Yep.
As long as that usually the time series the first type
yep.
I mean the load forecasting for usually takes the first type of the three figures that
yep.
are here.
So, well, actually, not quite, but anyway, depends on the depends on where you are. Yeah,
I know. They're not changing that much like the wind speed.
Yeah.
So I'm just wondering if
okay.
Concerning the because usually yep. in the climate used right now they use the probabilistic forecasting tools,
yep.
which is trying to because I got one of the slides as well that you said sir, that the seasonality is not that affecting that much. The
not in those particular. Farms, but it may well in others. Okay, but yeah. Okay. First off, that's the one thing I want to mention is that wind speed I thought was too hard. Okay, like you're saying, this is wind farm output, so it's already smoothed to a certain extent. Okay, the other thing is that the people that there's a number of people in Europe that. Work on this type of thing as well, and they're are from the Ecole des Mines in France, and they've also produced a forecasting tool called Animos, which you may have heard of. I don't know, and their vision is sort of similar to mine in a way that at low short time scales, probably the sort of time series forecasts are best. When you get out beyond a couple of hours, then you go to the numerical weather predictors or ANNs or whatever. I mean, the trouble, of course, with ANNs is that then how do you find out what sort of error bounds you've got? Okay, so they go to ensemble models and all that sort of stuff. So yeah, I think you're quite right in two ways. Well, the wind speed looked too hard to me, but the output's a little bit better. But you've got to do it on short time scales. I have no idea of going beyond a couple of hours. And that's the hope that we can sort of merge the two approaches together at the margins. Okay. Or even use one to inform the other as well.
Okay, perhaps we can take one more question. No more questions. Thank you. Thank you for your participation.